can Ms. Dobson, can you tell us why are you running for this seat?
Well, I'm running to make life better for Alabama families. I grew up in a very rural part of the district in Monroe County. Grateful to have grown up in a small town. I then went to Harvard for undergrad. I had an English teacher in my small high school who encouraged me to apply. She said, "You've got good grades. You should apply to the Ivies." And I thought, well, oh my goodness, my mom and her sister were the first to go to college in their families. They went to Auburn. My dad went to Auburn. But I'm grateful for a teacher who encouraged me. And so got into Harvard and went there for undergrad. I went to Baylor for law school. I practiced law in Texas for a few years out of law school, met my husband there, got married. But when I became pregnant with our first child, I knew there was nowhere else I'd rather raise my kids than Alabama. So we moved back to Alabama a little over 5 years ago. Since then, I now have two daughters. We live in Montgomery. I'm a real estate lawyer and I also serve on the Alabama Forestry Commission. I've never run for office before, but in the time we've been back in Alabama, I see some real needs. We have a huge brain drain problem in the district. We have incredible natural resources. We have wonderful people, and yet so many of our young people are leaving and never coming back. And I wanted to do everything I could to help create more opportunities in the area to ensure that our kids have safe communities and that we as a state and as a district are thriving and making the most of all that God has given us in the district. Because again, we have some incredible opportunities. We just have to have policies that allow us to unlock those opportunities and that also help us equip our young people with the skills that they need to succeed in the district.
Okay, thank you. And this is the first election in this newly for this newly drawn district too. So it was drawn to give minorities a bigger voice, that is, in the district and Alabama delegation as a whole. So regardless of the election turnout, do you believe the change in the district was warranted?
I think this is election has been so unique in Alabama because so often we don't have contested general elections, and that's really not healthy when you think about it. Because when all the action is in the primary, like it has been in five Alabama districts are Republican, and it's pretty unequivocally Republican, and then District 7 is unequivocally Democrat. All of the campaigning, all of the real contested part of the election is just in the primary. So you just have really one party kind of controlling the discussions and the policy debates. It all takes place in the primary, but that's not really reflective of what Alabama looks like, what America looks like. We all have different life experiences. We have different political opinions. And what's wonderful about this election is that we're talking about everything. We're talking about all issues that impact every single voter in this district. And again, the unique thing too about this race is that every single vote is going to count. And so I am encouraging folks and have been from day one to get registered. Registration actually ended this past Monday, but to be involved and to vote and to think about this race. And so I hope that this race has not only allowed people to think about all issues impacting their life and areas of policy, but also has encouraged more folks in this district to actually vote and participate. Because again, the apathy is a huge enemy that America is facing as a whole when only a tiny fraction of those who are registered to vote or who are eligible to vote make the decisions, then our government's not representative of our state as a whole, of our nation as a whole. And so it's really vital that everyone participates. In the Constitution, the right of the citizen to vote is one of the most sacred rights we have as citizens. And so would encourage anyone who is on the fence about whether or not they vote, take the time to become an informed voter and exercise your constitutional right to have a voice in this election.
And How do you think this change in this district will make an impact on the citizens that live in it?
Well, again, I think, I certainly feel that if elected, I'm representing every single person in this district. And again, in some of the other districts in the state, where most of the action is in the primary, I think you can see some representatives that maybe haven't campaigned in certain parts of the district because that's not where the primary voters are. That's not, and also, I'm not a politician, so I'm not, haven't approached this from necessarily a strategic perspective, but one in which if I'm going to represent everyone in this district, every family in this district, if I'm fighting to make life better for everyone in this district, then I need to leave no corner of this district unvisited. And so I'm so grateful for all the folks that have opened their homes, who've invited me to worship with them, to cheer on their kids' sports teams, folks that have been open-minded, folks that don't necessarily consider themselves Republican, that have been willing to share with me their concerns, what keeps them up at night. And so I think what's, again, really special about this race and how, in my opinion, all political races should be, is that everyone has a voice, and that's true. Every single voter is equal in the eyes of the law. And that's when I got into this race. I had some other retired politicians, folks that had served in county offices or even state offices that I met during the course of the campaign, and they said, "Well, you need to ask people for their vote." And I thought, well, if I'm talking to them and I'm a candidate, isn't that kind of implied that, I'm running for office, and do I need to really look them in the eyes and ask them for their vote? And they said yes, because really that is the one area in this country that we are all equal. Everyone has one single vote. And so it is so important that voters exercise that right, but also the representatives and elected officials that are representing the people of this district understand that they are accountable to every single person living in the district, regardless of whether they voted for them or not. I'm running to ensure that life is better for our families, that we have more economic opportunities, that we can lower gas and grocery prices, that we can make prescription drugs affordable again, and also that our kids have safe communities to live and play in.
Awesome. Thank you. Next topic, we're talking about immigration now. And so we know it's a hot topic, especially in this election cycle. With, recently some people in some communities have made complaints about migrants, primarily Haitian migrants in certain communities who have begun to, what they say, strain services in those areas. But according to the Census Office, Alabama is in the bottom half in both raw numbers and percentage of undocumented immigrants living in the state. So, how significant is the migrant issue in Alabama? And the part two question to that is how much federal resource in the state should be directed toward these people?
Well, I think when it comes to the relocation of the CHNV migrants, the issue is kind of the lack of communication with a lot of the local authorities before these refugees were located in these areas. And I can say, again, growing up in a town of less than 200, a lot of your small towns, a lot of your rural counties, their budget is down to the last dime. They are strained for resources, and they have to be very frugal with how they're already allocating their resources for the folks that live in their cities and counties. And so, I'm sure you may have seen the letter that Governor Ivey signed, along with some other governors throughout the country, just wanting more transparency with this program, and also wanting more prior notice, so that these, if there again is a small town or a rural county where migrants and refugees are going to be located pursuant to the CHNV program, that there is more communication and collaboration, because otherwise you're endangering the lives of those folks that have, been moved there with very little notice to the county. It's hard for, again, a city to or a small city to prepare for that. And so, again, I think it takes a lot more collaboration than we've seen with respect to that program. When it comes to undocumented immigrants and non-citizens that have come across our southern border, it's not just the sheer number, which again we've seen nationally that's estimated at 8 to 10 million non-citizens have come across our southern border in the past 3.5 years. But it's also, what's come across as well. It's the fentanyl. 80 to 90% of fentanyl precursors are manufactured in China. They cannot legally be imported into the United States. So the main path of entry is across our southern border, our open southern border. And you look at, at how that has impacted families in this district, and it's really hard to find a family that hasn't been impacted one way or another by the fentanyl crisis. My own godbrother in Montgomery died of a fentanyl overdose, and fentanyl, it's an epidemic that knows no boundaries. It impacts every zip code, every income level, every community. In Sims and Mobile, they've lost 3 young people to fentanyl overdose in just the past couple of months. So much of a crisis that there was a community-wide meeting the other night about this issue. So you see certainly a rise in fentanyl and other drugs, and also in trafficking. A little less than 2 months ago, Montgomery shut down a sex trafficking ring. It's estimated that during the Biden-Harris administration, over 320,000 minors were entirely lost track of. And hopefully, some of them haven't ended up as the victims of trafficking, but I think it's a fair assumption that some of them have. Additionally, ICE, about a month ago, released statistics showing that 662,000 individuals with known criminal histories have come across our border. 13,000 of those have known murder histories. So it's impacting all of our communities. Again, whether it's the strain on resources or it's the crime, the drugs. Again, also in Mobile County earlier this summer, a 19-year-old young man, Adam Linker, was killed by an undocumented citizen who had previously been arrested for DUI and let loose. And he, again, was drunk driving and took the life of this young man, this American citizen. We've also seen a strain on federal resources. It's estimated that $1.4 billion of taxpayer money has been spent on non-citizens. That has put a tremendous strain on the amount of funds that we have to take care of our citizens, especially those that have dealt with natural disasters such as Hurricane Helene, Hurricane Milton. And so, again, whether it's the strain on resources, whether it is the rise in crime, whether it's the fentanyl epidemic, we have to secure our southern border. We have to respect the sovereignty of our nation. And we also have to streamline the legal immigration process. Look, we absolutely need and want folks to come here the right way. But right now, I've met families in the district, who have families that are family members that are trying to come here, and they've been waiting years and years. So on the one hand, we've got this system that's been bottlenecked, and we've got to incentivize folks to come here the right way. On the migrant worker program front, we also have far too much overregulation, and the process is so burdensome and cumbersome. In fact, H-2B workers in 2022, which the Alabama timber industry is very reliant upon, there was a quota imposed in 2022. So halfway through 2022, no more H-2B workers were allowed to come to the United States. And as you and I know, American companies, if they try to hire Someone who's not here legally, they could face fines and repercussions on the legal front. So we've got to really streamline and overhaul our immigration process to ensure that we can continue to benefit from legal migration, but that we do have a secure border that's not allowing the criminals, the drugs, and other national and local security threats.
And I want to be sure the how much federal resources in the state should be directed toward those people.
Well, I'm not a expert on our state budget, and so I currently do not know how much of our state resources are allocated towards addressing and dealing with humanitarian efforts when it comes to the migrant process or refugee process. But I do know we certainly have to prioritize the needs of citizens and Alabamians in this state, because in the second congressional district, there are folks that live and work and have worked all their lives in Alabama, and they don't have access to adequate infrastructure, to adequate sewage. And so we certainly, again, I'm not running for a state office, but I would certainly encourage our state officials to make sure that they're using funds wisely to ensure for the health, safety, and education of Alabama citizens.
Let's talk about the job. So, according to labor numbers, Alabama has fewer unemployed workers than jobs that are open. Overall, unemployment is down, but many still live under the poverty line, too. So, what needs to be done at the federal level to improve the quality of jobs in Alabama? And then I'll ask the second question after that.
Okay, sorry. Whatever you prefer. Yes, no, I mean, the unemployment numbers are down in Alabama, but you also have to look at the workforce participation rate, which is only 57%. That means 43% of eligible workers are not either not finding jobs or aren't equipped for jobs. And so we have to do a much better job of connecting those dots. That all starts with a strong economy. We have got to get inflation down. We have got to curb overregulation that stymies the growth of especially small businesses. And we have to be energy independent again, so that many of our businesses can continue to thrive and grow. You look at agriculture, for instance. Well, fertilizer is a direct byproduct of non-renewable resources. And so when you have energy policies like you see in the Biden-Harris administration, that's causing fertilizer prices to have increased over 40% in the last 3.5 years. That really hurts small family farms. Energy prices also impact Alabama manufacturing, which is also a huge sector of the economy in the second congressional district. Since 2001, Alabama has lost approximately 42,000 manufacturing jobs. And part of the reason also is that we have a federal Department of Education that, in their post-secondary funding, they only allocate about a fifth of their post-secondary funding to non-traditional college paths. So, to direct career training, to vocational programs. And we need to see a lot more of that. I'm grateful for our state legislature really focusing on workforce development. But we have got to do a better job of exposing young people to careers they can have in their own backyards, and ones that are allow them to be incredibly successful, to have their own business, or to have a great job with fantastic benefits at a lot of the wonderful companies that we have in the district. You can look at some really innovative pilot programs that you've seen throughout South Alabama. One example is Baldwin Prep Academy, that starts in seventh grade with exposing young people and training them for careers in building science and in electric work and plumbing and welding. Another example in the district is over in Troy. Troy Bank and Trust actually has a financial center in one of the high schools there, and so it helps. Well, certainly it helps teach young people financial financial literacy, which is so very important, but also exposes them to careers in the banking world, some that involve college and some that don't. So I think we need to, and again, I admire the state legislature for their work on this, and also for kind of changing the narrative that, you know, encouraging and equipping young people to go to college if that's what their dream is and that would equip them for success, but also recognizing that there are some really important careers that can lead to a great quality of life that don't necessarily involve college. So many of our assets and natural resources in this district are in rural areas, and in developing and maximizing those resources, you know, require workers that are specifically trained and equipped, but don't necessarily involve a 4-year college degree. So I think we need to do a much better job connecting the dots. But again, all that is premised on having a strong economy where businesses are continuing to grow and be built.
And the second part question ties into the business aspect about, you know, improving the quality of jobs, but also the necessary supply needed to for the workforce to help those businesses fill their needs. If you can add to that.
Yes, absolutely. Well, I think, you know, we really need to take a customized approach too. There was an economic impact study done. I mean, this was years ago, even. I think it was about 6 years ago, that showed that the impact of creating one job in Bullitt County was the equivalent of creating 27 jobs in Montgomery County, just next door. So in our rural areas, we really need a focus on, you know, ensuring that we have economic policies that continue to foster the growth of small businesses, and also, you know, lower the barrier to entry when it comes to small businesses getting off the ground. And the key to that, again, is massive deregulation. It is so hard for a small business owner with a dream who's willing to work hard and make the sacrifices to get his or her business off the ground to make it in today's world in this economy. You know, you look at small community banks, you look at credit unions, you talk to anyone, they're vastly overregulated. But in so many small communities, this is the key to an individual getting the capital to get his or her business off the ground. So we have to have, you know, certainly we have to have a regulatory system to protect citizens from bad actors, but we need to rethink how that is playing out, especially in our small communities, because right now our regulatory framework seeks to consolidate and control instead of inspiring innovation and entrepreneurship. And that's what we need to see, most especially again in our small towns. I'm very passionate about increasing the quality of life in our small towns, because that's where I'm from, and that's where the heartbeat of this district is. Certainly we have so many incredible opportunities in Mobile and Montgomery, but we also need our small towns to flourish as well.
Great, thank you. So let's talk about education now. I have three more topics after education, just to, I think right now it says we have 8 minutes and 54 seconds. So I want to get as much topics in so that, you
Sure, I'll
know.
be less long-winded.
No, you're good. You're good. But also, you know, I want, you know, the people who will be voting in District 2 to understand where you stand on all things.
Sure.
So Alabama's K-12 education woes are well documented. So from a federal perspective, does the solution lie in supporting public education, a privatized system, or something else?
Like, you know, I am the granddaughter of two public school teachers. Education is the key to everything in this district, to the key to each and every individual child's success, and also to the future of our state. And we have got to take a fresh and innovative approach when it comes to our education. Right now, the major problem is that the vast majority of our federal taxpayer education dollars stay trapped in DC. The average federal Department of Education employee in DC makes over $100,000 a year, whereas the average Alabama public school teacher, average, so probably the average is lower in the second congressional district, their average annual salary is $53,000 a year. So we need that funding to come to the states and to local school boards, because again, it certainly varies county by county as to what the needs are, but we have got to have our federal education dollars follow our students and our teachers, and we don't need to be funding more Washington bureaucrats up in Washington. If you look at the increase in administration too, this is Department of Education statistics, but between 2000 and 2019, there was about a 7.6% increase in number of public school students. During the same time period, there was about a little less than 9% increase in number of teachers, which was great because it means that there's a better student to teacher ratio. During the same period, there was an 87.6% increase, 87.6% increase in number of administrators. That is where the vast majority of our federal taxpayer dollars are going, and that needs to be redirected to create more opportunities for students and also to attract more and teachers to again, teaching is such a calling, and we need to compensate our teachers, to congratulate them and thank them for all that they do for inspiring our young people.
Thank you. So, so-called climate change has been the subject of much discussion and much spending at the federal level. So, while the United States emission of greenhouse gases is second in the world, still less than half of what China emits. So, year over year, the U.S. did increase by nearly 2%, but the U.S. decrease since the year 2000 led the major countries of the world. So, do you think climate change is impacting Alabama? If so, how? And should the federal government focus significant resources to tackle climate change? And if yes, what should those resources be?
Look, I grew up in rural Alabama. I'm so grateful for the natural beauty that we have here. The Mobile River Delta is the Amazon of North America. There is more biodiversity in the Mobile River Delta than there is in the entire state of California. So we've got a very special natural environment. We have to fight to protect that. I'm a commissioner on the Alabama Forestry Commission, and one of their major goals is to help educate Alabamians about not only the economic opportunities and the natural beauty of Alabama's forests, but also what a role that plays in our sustainability. And so, if you actually look at the states of Alabama, Mississippi, and Georgia, because so much of these three states is forested, in Alabama that's 23.1 million acres, there's actually been a cooling trend over the past 100 years. So we as Alabamians have an incredible story to tell and an incredible role to play. And so again, I think we certainly need to be incentivizing the growth and development of the timber industry. There's never been a more global demand for wood products. So ensuring that we are meeting those needs, and again, creating opportunities and jobs when it comes to wood products manufacturing, to bioenergy, to cross-laminated timber to be used in building. You can actually create a building that is carbon neutral with cross-laminated timber that actually sustains that with withholds and sustains in hurricanes much better than some steel buildings. So Alabama has a really significant role to play, and we need to have federal policies that again are encouraging innovation rather than seeking to control. The second congressional district also is home to one of the nation's largest plastic recycling facilities, KW Plastics in Troy. They were started out of ingenuity back in the 70s, and now they are again one of the nation's top plastics recyclings. However, because of the regulations of this administration, they may have to close one of their facilities because this administration is over-regulating a recycling facility. Something that we should, again, we need to reevaluate how these regulations are playing out and how they're being applied because that again, that is a story that we as Alabamians should be telling more.
Okay, great. And if you do go over time, please know I will send another link so that we can finish out the rest of the questions. I want to be very fair and give you a lot of time to answer.
That is very
So we've talked about climate change. Let's talk about election security now. So Alabama recently ordered the scrubbing of voter rolls. Over 3,000 names were allegedly found to be non-citizens and ordered to be removed. The federal government has sued, saying it's too late to make this move, but Alabama's voting process itself revolves around paper ballots. Alabama is also a state that requires an ID to vote. So do you think in Alabama that there is a fair process and secure, and it's secure from outside attacks? And if not, how should it be changed?
Again, as I said earlier, we have an apathy problem, and we need to encourage each and every Alabama citizen to take the time to be registered and to participate and to vote. And I hope that every single person that's eligible to vote in District 2 goes out to the polls or votes absentee if they're not going to be in town on November 5th. That is, again, the most sacred right of citizenship is the right to vote. Part of protecting that right means also ensuring that non-citizens who are not who've have not either were born in the United States or have not taken an oath of citizenship don't vote. And so, because when we allow non-citizens to vote, then that diminishes your voice and my voice. That in effect, dilutes the power that we as American citizens have to vote. And so that's why, if elected, I would certainly vote in favor of legislation like the SAVE Act, which you saw all but five Democrats vote against. That was just legislation saying that only American citizens can vote in American elections, basically a codification of what the Constitution states. So I will be an advocate for ensuring that every Alabama citizen can vote and gets registered to vote and has access to registration. But at the same time, part of protecting that right that is so sacred is ensuring that non-citizens are not allowed to vote.
Awesome. And we have 1 minute, and this is about IVF. So I have three questions about it. What's your stance on, if we get cut off, I'm about to send Sailor a link, but
Okay.
what's your stance on Alabama's Supreme Court's decision on IVF?
But no, as a mother, my most precious gifts are my two daughters. My older daughter turned 5 yesterday, and I have so many friends and family that have utilized the IVF process. I truly believe it's a God-given technology to allow the miracle of life to families who thought they may not be able to experience that. And so I'm a staunch supporter of IVF and IVF access. I'm grateful that our state legislature worked so quickly to ensure that access, to restore that access to Alabama families. But even those few weeks in between the Supreme Court decision and the state legislature's action, there were a lot of potential mothers that were impacted, a lot of families that were impacted, because as you and I know, it's a very time-sensitive process. It's a very expensive process, and one that takes a huge emotional and physical toll on a lot of women in this state. So I'm firmly committed to ensuring that we never have that uncertainty again when it comes to access to IVF.
Great. And for parents who rely on IVF to expand their families, how can you reassure them that Alabama is and will be a safe place to continue treatments at the clinics that still provide the service?
I think a huge part of that is introducing legislation. I would like to introduce companion legislation to Senator Britt's IVF Protection Act that she introduced in the U.S. Senate. Unfortunately, that was voted down by Democrats, but it would have ensured access to IVF in all 50 states without question. And so I intend to introduce similar legislation. But again, I would also encourage families utilizing IVF to make their voices heard. I know there are a lot of nonprofits that have arisen in the state. One is Fighting for Alabama Families. Corinna Bryan is amazing, the work that she's doing. So I would encourage families to reach out to me if elected. If not elected, I still want to help in any way that I can to make sure that that access is ensured. But certainly if I'm elected, please give me a call, share your story, let me know your concerns, because again, I think we have got to, not I think, I know, and I'm committed on day one to taking action to ensuring that we never have that uncertainty when it comes to IVF access, and to making people more aware of that technology too, making more families that could potentially utilize that technology, making them aware and increasing access.
And should they keep their embryos in the state?
I feel is an issue that is a little bit more kind of jurisdictional. But I think we certainly need to, if there is a family that has undergone IVF and the embryos are destroyed due to reckless actions, then there needs to be some way of addressing that. But we have to ensure that all families have access to IVF, and in compensating a family for the the halt to that process in a particular case, it should not jeopardize the availability of this technology to other families. So there's a balance that has to be achieved there.
Is there anything else you want to add for me? That's all for my questions, but is there anything else that you'd like to add?
Yes, again, I'm so grateful for the opportunity to potentially represent this district. And I'm fighting hard to make life better for Alabama families. That's why I got in this race. I'm just a working mom, like many folks watching. I am a mother of two, proud to be raising my kids in South Alabama, but I know that we can do better for our families. And so I'm committed to bringing down gas and grocery prices. I'm committed to ensuring that our neighborhoods are safer and that our kids have opportunities in this district. I am running against someone who's a Washington insider. He started leasing an apartment in the district 2 days before the filing deadline. This is a race between someone who's an outsider, who's a working parent, just like many of you, who wants change, and someone who's from Washington who wants to maintain the status quo. And so I'm asking each and every one of you that live in the 2nd Congressional District, let's make a change. Let's make a difference for our kids. And please, I humbly ask for your vote on November 5th.